Good evening, please rise for pledge allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening and welcome to the Hampton Board of Selectmen's meeting for December 12th. First thing we have is public comment period. Is there anybody from the public that would like to speak? Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the board for announcements and community calendar. Gina?
Yeah, I just wanted to announce that Tracy Dewhurst, owner of the Victoria Inn, is having her annual holiday open house tomorrow at the inn. And if anyone wants to go, it starts at 5:30 and it's a great time. You should come check it out.
I'm set.
Phil?
Negative, sir. Thank you.
Rick?
Thank you.
I'd just like to say I was at the Wreath Across America today that they held at the American Legion. It was pretty nice to see all the middle school kids get out with their flags as the trucks started to pull up. It was also nice to see a large number of families at the ceremony. It was also nice to see our police and fire departments there. I think they did an excellent job. If you've never had a chance to see that, hopefully next year if they come through town again, you'll get a chance.
Oh, yeah.
The gentleman that got up and spoke, it was amazing because I guess he has got up and spoke before when they've been here. But when he starts to talk about all the wreaths that they put on the cemeteries, and they still need more wreaths, and how he goes in to talk about how he feels that if one of those families that didn't get a wreath because they don't have enough of it. So if you want to learn more about it, talk to the American Legion, wreathsacrossamerica.org. It was a nice presentation. They're heading down there. There was 10 tractor trailer full, and there were at least 10 or 15 support vehicles that were going down with that, along with other police departments from throughout the state and from out Maine. So I want to thank them for their service, thank them for doing it, thank our police and fire departments for being part of that, thank the Hampton American Legion for hosting that today. It was really a nice event. So, all right. First thing we have is the approval of the minutes, November 28th.
I'll make a motion to approve the November 28th minutes.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. December 5th. Non-public session. Motion to approve.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. First appointments we have are Diana Martin, Parks and Recreations. First thing is Five Corners Playground Equipment. Good evening, Diana.
Good evening.
How are you?
Good. So I had a bid go out for the Five Corners Playground, and I got 3 bids back. So I'm just here tonight to ask permission to award a bid to one of these 3 companies. And I sent out, excuse me, a little graph that I had made about each of the 3 companies. And the one that I'm hoping to have the bid awarded to is Altiplay, which was in the middle. However, the low bidder, which was Emmy O'Brien, they substituted a piece of equipment that was of a lesser value and a smaller piece of equipment for one of the products that we asked for. They also didn't include a sign, and they didn't include freight in it, so their bid was much lower than these other two.
Do you have any questions for Diana?
It was much lower, but it didn't include...
It didn't include the freight, it didn't include a playground safety sign, and it included... The swing set is the piece that's a different piece.
Okay. And the company that you want to go with, where are they located?
They're in Uxbridge, Mass. And they're still under the amount of money that we have, so all 3 of them were under.
Rick?
So how much money did that company not put into the bid?
Well,
what percentage?
Well, the difference in the bids was about $10,000.
Mm-hmm.
The 2 higher bidders were about $600 apart. So I looked at this other one because that was a huge red flag that this company was so far off. And the difference was they had put in a swing set that was approximately $6,000. And the other two had put in the swing set that I had asked for, which is a much bigger swing set that was about $11,000. And they also, they didn't put in the freight. They left me a message on here stating that I would have to call Landscape Structures to get that freight quote. And they also left off approximately an $800 sign. Mm-hmm. So it's a difference of $10,000.
Thank you.
And so you sent it out to 10 bidders, and these are the three that you got back.
Yes, these are the three that came to the mandatory site walk, and they also sent bids in.
Okay, so I'm going to need a motion.
I'll make a motion that we approve to accept the second lowest bidder.
I'll second that.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
And then just the donations for the tree lighting.
Yep. You want to go through that?
Service Credit Union and the Hampton Chamber of Commerce always give us donations every year to go towards some of the cost of the tree lighting.
Mm-hmm.
And this year the Service Credit Union gave us $1,000 and the Chamber of Commerce gave us $800. And I just wanted to get approval to accept those donations.
I'll make that motion and say thank you to Service Credit Union and Hampton Area Chamber of Commerce.
Second it, buddy.
And I'll second that.
All those in favor? Have we sent them a letter yet to thank them for that?
We send them one every year.
Okay, very good.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Next one's Chris Jacobs. Jen Hale.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
So the first thing on the our agenda was to bring you up to speed on the bicentennial seawall repair. Jen's going to brief you on that because some of the numbers have been coming in fast and furious just today.
So since we last met and did an update, we had reached out to some contractors to find out what could we do or what should we do based on our engineer's recommendation to temporary repair, and I'm calling it temporary because it's protection, it's stabilization. What do we need to do to get that wall so we don't lose it during a storm, whether it slides in, falls over? The idea is to use the revetment stone, very similar to what the state has done. It would come out about 16 feet from the wall. It's large stone. It would be stacked up, basically be used for wave breaking and wave reflection at the wall base in an effort to hold it there until we can get to such point in time to have a final design permits and a, what I'm going to call the final repair. So when I'm saying temporary and final being the reconstruction. Those numbers have been coming in. We're using about $180,000 as a placeholder. That's what we're understanding from any type of temporary permit application, any type of the contractor's fees. What we're finding every day we go down there, and we went down with DOT today, walked the site with them to talk about the drainage outfall that needs some work. I went out with the engineer last week, is the sand is still eroding. So more and more of that foundation to the actual seawall is being exposed. And we're actually now seeing old pieces of wall that have come over in time that used to be covered over in sand with large pieces of rebar sticking up. So again, you know, in our mind, safety, not wanting people down by the rebar that's sticking out, and then those costs to remove those broken pieces of concrete and the rebar to get them out of there and to bring in the stone is what's in that 180. Ty and Bond has produced the memo that was replaced what I had originally sent to you. They did a formal memo that is on the website. We have notified, I think I'm going to try to go through the whole list here, but it's DES, NHDOT, Army Corps, Coast Guard, all of you, and I know I'm missing someone, so I apologize, but we really to get out there and not just to let him know that we're having an issue, but in the event that there were failure, to ask for assistance to work with us through the process. So with that, Time Bond has written a final report, so meaning everything in report form, some old pictures of the old Coast Guard station, the historical accounts, the concrete reactions that are going on with the existing wall. They've made some recommendations as far as how would we like to move forward in the future. Those are things that we just received that Chris and I will need to go through so we can intelligently bring the engineer with us to show you those options. But looking to present you with this information and try to determine a next step. The protection of the wall or the temporary repair at $180, that is a fee. To go into the design, you know, for the new wall, for what would be the permanent fix, there's also a fee. There's the engineering, permitting, design. We'd be looking to do grants, grant assistance. And if you put that all together, it's about $298,000. And then there's the cost of the wall replacement, which the engineers' estimates have come in between, and depending on, again, the choices that we'd want to go through with you, you know, between 1.8 and 2.2 million. So that 2 million we gave you the other day was smack dab in the middle, but the costs that have come in to match what they're recommending are in that range. So that's what we've been busy trying to get our hands wrapped around and do and move forward. I think from here, Chris, what are your thoughts?
We're at a turning point. Saw the pictures from 2 weeks ago. I was amazed at the way the wall looks today. On the northern end, where the ramp is that goes down to the ocean, there's a whole new section. Obviously, there was a wall there. There's a whole new footing exposed that no one knew was there. There's rebar exposed. Along the front of the wall, I'm even perplexed how to, I want to permanently cordon it off because there's pointed pieces of rebar there, pieces of metal literally sticking out of the wall. And it's obvious that this wall that's present today is actually built behind one that was there before. And the reason why we never saw it is it was under 4 feet of sand. Well, that 4 feet of sand is not there anymore. The whole bottom of the wall is exposed. If anyone was under the impression that the wall will make it through the winter, I don't think that impression, that you should stick with that impression. It's obvious that a really good storm is just going to come along and erode the sand out from the bottom of the wall, and it will either tip forward or fall, depending on how the erosion goes, tip forward or backwards. Jennifer was correct. We did meet and we talked with or sent an email, I should say, to the Division 6 engineer a week ago at the urging of Ty and Bond to say, hey, we need you, you've got something out there too. They've got a pipe that takes discharges or carries the discharge water off of Route 1. That's fully exposed more than I've ever seen it. It used to be the whole pipe was covered. It's fully exposed now. It's losing the water.
About halfway down. When we say fully exposed, you can see that part A of the pipe doesn't connect to part B. There's actually a void in the concrete pipe.
So we met, the gentleman we met with is Ralph Sanders. He's one of the, I call him a field engineer. He's the guy that they assign when there's a problem. Ralph, go look at it. Very decent and honorable gentleman to work with. We've worked together in the past. Ralph's even perplexed where he's going to find the money, but it's obvious to him that he's got an immediate problem also, because this is a conduit that could allow beach water back in on Route 1. And we even walked the top of the wall, and he saw some of the erosion, and already the wall's being overtopped. There's a rivulet, probably the width of this desk, where water's currently going down to Route 1. And so he fully understands the problem. He and I and Jennifer all had to talk about the process that it's going to take to get this going, the issues that he faces on his side and our side. So there's two things that are going on or that need to be happened. There's the immediate concern of the safety of the seawall, the need to put the revetment stone in now, and then there's the follow-through that we need to do to make sure that, or hopefully, that the warrant article for the seawall gets approved in March. Those are the two things that we need to do now. As Jennifer stated, that, you know, the short-term cost is $180 right now to put the revetment stone on the other side. Stones that are probably two or three times the size of this table. That's the only thing that'll handle it. We see that how the stones that we had there before have either been literally pushed around like toys. The stones that are only half the size of this table in height or in thickness, they're literally just being pushed around. But then if we want to get something done, we ought to think about encumbering some money and proceeding through with a design contract now, because it's going to take 6 to 9 months to get this permitted, even with an emergency permit. We just can't. This isn't something that you emergency permit and go out next week and start working on a repair. So
right. And we've had initial conversations with DES regarding that emergency notification. So even to do the revetment, the protection end of this, we will need an emergency permit. It would be issued in a similar fashion when the force main. We work with Evan Lewis up at the state. It's a very open communication. They understand it needs to be done. Carlos Adams and Evan, I've spoken to both of them at this point through email, and they understand the situation. But then there's the whole other permitting. So when I say the final or the wall replacement or in repair, I mean, that's another 6 to 9 process, and that's the full dredge and fill permit. So there's two cycles that have to be gone through.
Fred, do you have anything you want to add to it, or?
Well, obviously the $180,000 is going to come out of the existing budget, so it can't come from anywhere else. So the board would have to give direction to divert whatever funds are available in the town appropriation schedule to meet that criteria if they agree.
True.
Two, we will need all the information that's required to put together a warrant article. We already have an article, but as far as funds are concerned and wherever they would be earmarked, because I think that's fairly well important at this point in time. You're going to have to basically build a new seawall.
Yes.
Or it may not be there because you may not be able to get the riprap in front of it in order to protect it. So can you get the riprap?
We have. And we've spoken to multiple contractors that have the riprap. We have sourcing. The engineer has been working for it. This riprap is 5 to 8 ton rock. And you know, trying, and I say it like that because he said that little rock, you know, that little rock move. So, I mean, you're talking 4 pieces of rock to a flatbed trailer. I mean, this is multiple trips and staging and is quite a laborious process. And, you know, go figure, working with the tide schedule, the daylight schedule and everything else. I mean, it's a project.
One of the contractors laid out the process that it was 11 days of hauling stone from their particular source yard, stone on a flatbed truck, get it here, literally lift it off and set it somewhere in that vicinity of Bicentennial Park, and then another 3 days to a week, depending on tide schedule, to literally get it set on the other side so that it protects the seawall. This almost sounds like a re-scripting or a re-explanation of what we gave you for the Church Street force main. But there is a supreme difference in that this $180,000, that stone that we're going to buy and get transported, can be used in the final implementation, the final design of the seawall. So it isn't like the force main where we built a $120,000 road to nowhere to literally have it then pulled back and we no longer have the road. In this case, we'd spend $180,000 to get the stone there. We'd have the stone
already there.
And it would be used or incorporated in part of the final design, i.e. to even protect the seawall once it gets done. Same way the state has revetment stone in front of their seawall. So in this particular case, it is not a frivolous...
It's not just a means to get somewhere. Yeah, it's actually part of the solution.
Right. It's not the road to nowhere. It's revetment stone for the final solution.
So, are you going to need heavy stone, small stone, in order to bolster up the existing foundation of the dam, the seawall that's there?
I'm sure that... I hate to call it chink. We call it typically in the business chinking stone.
Right.
And normally it's stone I can put my hands around. The chinking stone in this situation would be I can't put my hands around it. Would some of that more than likely have to come? Yes. I don't want to pretend to tell the contractors how to do the job, but it's obvious to me that you would need, on every one of these jobs, chinking stones because you just can't literally hold two stones at 9 tons apiece. Wedge them up against each other and expect that they're going to stay there without any chinking stones to take up the voids.
Right.
And these will be embedded, a certain depth, and there will be fabric as well to help migration of fines. Right. I mean, it's part of an engineered temporary solution.
Right. The other thing that we're working on, because it's recently exposed in the last 3 weeks, is all that concrete that you now see down there. I mean, there's footings there, but there's actually wall sections that are tipped over, still attached to their original footings by the rebar. All that would need to come out, because that's like, we can't set this new revetment stone on that. It'd be like setting it on marbles. It'd just literally wash back out to sea. So that's part of the process.
All right, well, I'll bring it back to the board. Phil, you want?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Director and Assistant Director. Really important stuff. The riprap, this big riprap. If you head up to Rye, they've got riprap right next to 1A. It's next to much smaller walls. The ocean's right there as well. The buck 80 is a buck 80. Is that what the numbers are?
Mm-hmm.
And that's just the contracting cost. That doesn't count your time and effort and your integration. It's great. And it's something we've known about. I applaud Mr. Welch and your efforts on it. It's dangerous. That's what we're here for. And it speaks to the issue of budgets, and it speaks to the issue of people that whittle down, and we encourage people to be interested in their budget, associations and taxpayers and citizens, and we all pay taxes, and nobody wants to pay more than we do. But when these exigencies and contingencies manifest their ugly heads and it endangers public life, public safety, or endangers our way of life, our tax base, our businesses, that's when these people that always whittled down to 0 cents, and we had a speaker in here last week that can tell you the cost of everything but the value of nothing, it's important that we act on it. So I support what you're doing. Thank you, and thank you for coordinating it off down there. I saw your vehicle down there this afternoon on my run. And I know you're on it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
I think this is something that needs to be done, and, I'm looking to go forward.
Gina?
I agree. I think it's $180,000. What will we have to make a motion for that we can take that out of
the existing budget? No, we can't take it from reserves. That's kind of the existing budget.
The existing budget. Right. So would that be something that could this be done as soon as it...
All three contractors that we have spoken to, and we'll have to work through that, and you'll see us again, with the final contract, are all able to start now.
And we have the funds?
We're going to have to find them in the budget. We're going to start stripping some funds out of the budget in order to do this. But it's an emergency, and we can't afford to have the seawall disappear, and with it, we're 1A. And the park, because that's exactly what happened in the 1700s, so we don't need a repeat of that. So
I agree.
Yeah, I agree 100%. Living right down there, living across the street, so I see that all the time. Please do it.
Sorry.
Yeah, and being an old runner down there, as Mr. Bean said one day, I'm there frequently, and you can see how dangerous it is, and I just hope people realize that it's not something that you're coming here saying, we got, if that thing, I think I heard of one other committee or something, somebody say, do you need that wall? If that wall, I've seen the water with the wall there come up and run down High Street.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, the wall is absolutely necessary. There's no...
I mean, we were shown one storm that you folks were here, I wasn't here, then 2010, where sand literally washed up over, yeah, you know, the beach. And the contract then in 2010 was 400,000 yards of sand. It all had to be removed at several hundred thousand dollars.
Yeah.
At least our 180 expenditure, we're getting something of value that we can use and reuse. And it's something that can secure the wall for this winter, so we can rest easier knowing that it'll make it through the winter.
I will make a motion that we find some place in the budget.
Places in the budget.
Place in the budget to get the $180,000 to do the repairs or the revetment.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And that can happen, like you said, as soon as you can come back.
We will start working on getting the contracts pulled together and back to Fred and Christina to bring back to you for...
And I'm sure tomorrow morning I'll be meeting with Fred to identify accounts and monies.
And the finance director.
And we most of us have been down there and seen the work you've already done to secure what you have down there, and we appreciate that. I mean, it's...
We wouldn't want to see people injure themselves. There's still walkers down there and joggers, and, yeah, it's... critical. The other item that we're here to discuss with you is a vote to accept the donation of a used polymer blending system at the wastewater treatment plant. If you may remember that earlier this year, we were before the board to accept a sludge pump. So this used polymer blending system would come from that same plant that we got the sludge pump from. By the way, the pump's working well. It's installed. This polymer blending system, while it has no value to the current plant that it's in or was in, it's been disassembled, would have value to us because it would allow us to, we put it right next to where we mix the sludge, or we blend sludge, prior to that dewatering system we put in 2 years ago. We add polymer, a chemical, to allow us to bind the sludge up, basically. And this would give us some additional flexibility to use different or multiple polymers to accomplish the task. Hopefully save us money. The only cost it would be is for us, our staff, to install it. And but to get it, zero cost, just like the prior sludge pump.
Any questions? Need a motion?
I make a motion that we accept the donation, zero cost.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
That's all I have.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chief Sawyer in the police department.
Chief Sawyer stepped up on an emergency phone call.
Okay. Christy Pullman. You are here for the gasoline and diesel budget items.
Yes, I am here for the gasoline and diesel budget items. When we talked about all of the gasoline and diesel lines in the budget, all along we have said that we would continue to monitor the gallons used and the price that we were paying per gallon, and that we would possibly wish to adjust those numbers at some point during the budget process as we got further data and collected it throughout the year. So I have, I sent to you guys, I think, last Friday or the Friday before, I believe, a summary showing you lots of information, but basically what it boils down to is in the current 2017 budget, the gallons we have not made too many adjustments to, but we have adjusted the price. We went back and I was able to gather some great data from using the WEX program that we're using, and I was able to come up with the average price that we're paying for unleaded and diesel. And after looking at that and talking to Fred and Jamie both, we've decided that it would be best to adjust the gallon price for unleaded and the gallon price for diesel. So in 2016. Well, we started using the program in December of 15, so I had all of that data to go from. And the average price per gallon for unleaded that we had paid over that period of time, let me look at my sheet here so I don't get it wrong, was $1.63. And the average price that we paid for diesel was $1.76. We felt cutting it to bare bones minimum like that was a little risky, so we added back in 12 cents per gallon for unleaded and diesel. So we came up with new rates of $1.75 per gallon for unleaded and $1.88 per gallon for diesel fuel. So that's a 20 cents per gallon less for unleaded and 47 cents per gallon less for diesel. That's less than what's in the current budget right now. So it ended up being a savings of $40,069. So
across the board?
Across the board, yes. And we also were hoping to make an adjustment so that in each department, since we have all of this data that we have been able to gather from the WEX program, but it doesn't separate it out into, you know, how Public Works has the different departments like transfer station and highways and streets and all of that. So we were hoping that we would condense and have a gasoline and diesel line for the police department, a gasoline and diesel line for the fire department, a gasoline and diesel line for public works, cemetery, all of that, instead of having multiple gasoline and diesel line items across all of their budgets, so that we could just take these numbers and then we would be able to monitor our gallons every year, track them all, track the price we're paying per gallon, and have it all in one section of each of the departments. So we don't want just one gasoline and diesel line, but one in each department that has gasoline and diesel lines. So
that's not something you can do this year, obviously, because we've already done that. Is that what you're saying, or you want to do that now?
We would like to do that in the 17 budget if the board wishes to go back and change the money.
Yep.
Because obviously there's a $40,000 worth of savings that we've realized that we can adjust the 17 budget by. And if we do, if the board chooses to do that, then we can also move those lines too, to combine the lines.
Questions from the board?
Negative, sir.
Burke?
Yeah, Chrissy, great job. So, what's the number again? 40,000?
It's about $40,069.
In savings?
Yes. Over what was in, what we had in the 17 proposed budget, yes.
Okay. And yes, that's great. And yeah, I think it's a good idea to do that and to do it now rather than later.
Absolutely.
And then we can start tracking it this year.
Jim?
Yeah, I think it's great. The savings great. And that's a reflection on the exact miles and stuff. I mean, so you went back.
Gallons, yeah. The gallons we found were pretty accurate in what we had proposed to you guys. But once we started to really dig into the price per gallon that the town was paying because we don't have to pay the taxes, we realized that we should make an adjustment in the price per gallon, and that's where you really see most of the savings. We only adjusted the gallons slightly because they were pretty much right on. Because we were already monitoring those closely, but we hadn't really dug deep into, because I didn't realize all the reports that we were able to obtain and stuff like that.
So that new WEX system we went through last year is really working out well.
Yes, because I think, Fred, I think, well, were we paying $2.37 at the state for unleaded, I believe? That was the last?
Sometimes higher.
Yeah, but I mean, I think that was the lowest that we had been paying, right. And that's why the budget number. So we had in the budget a couple years ago, like $3.20 for diesel, and now we're going to put in the budget for 17, hopefully. We're going to put in $1.88. So a big difference there.
Absolutely.
Good, thank you.
Okay, so then I will prepare
a motion for you to do that?
I'll make a motion that we approve these new diesel and gasoline rates.
I'll second it.
And change
and we adjust the line items on the budget so that each department has one gas and diesel.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Great. Thank you.
Very good. Chief Sawyer, how are you?
Apologize, Mr. Chairman, for stepping out of the call I had to take.
Nope. Hey, duty call.
Good evening.
First item is police emergency vehicle equipment purchasing policy waiver, recommending Adamson Industries based upon the bids that we put out. We had three letters we sent out. One company failed to even submit a bid. Second company's
sent a letter providing you this letter of no response related to the bid. They're just overwhelmed with the number of vehicles they're dealing with. So the bid I'm recommending is Adamson Industry for the upfitting of our new cruisers for the amount of $22,350.
Any questions? Have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
And what does that include? What the outfitting?
The upfitting includes a lot of stuff.
So
the interior of the vehicle, it's going to be radios, all the electronic components are going to a car. And if you look into a cruiser these days, it looks like a cockpit on a fighter jet, the way we have so much stuff in there and the electronics. Then right outside to the white bar and the paint and the decaling of the vehicles. So it's quite an encompassing job.
And where are they located?
Adamson Industries is located in Haverhill, Massachusetts.
Any other questions? Have a motion and second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Second item is the acceptance of a New Hampshire Department of Safety Law Enforcement Opiate Abuse Reduction Initiative. This is grant funding for interdiction patrols. This particular grant we did multi-jurisdictional. It's Hampton PD, Portsmouth PD, and Greenwood PD. We're targeting the area of major corridors into the state where opiates could be brought into our communities, being Route 95, 1A, Route 1, 33, 101, that come through most of the communities involved. It's the amount of just under $59,000, which will be shared amongst the communities. We pick selective dates. We can be in any of the three communities, and we coordinate based on intelligence through our detective units as to what areas we should patrol. It includes uniform patrol and unmarked patrol.
Motion to accept.
I'll make a motion.
Motion by Rick, seconded by Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous.
That's all I have tonight. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you.
Good.
Next thing is the town manager's report.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the opportunities to submit petition to warrant articles for amendments to the zoning ordinance expires at 5 p.m. this coming Wednesday. Petitions are to be delivered to the selectman's office as required by statute. Warrant articles concerning other subjects not involving zoning can be submitted until 5 p.m. January 10th, 2017, and should be delivered to the selectman's office before that time. Been brought to my attention that individuals have been have portable basketball hoops in our streets in various locations in the community. Please remove them back into your own property as they interfere with plowing and wings, and we do not want to damage them, but we need to have them off the streets so snow plowing operations will not be interfered with. Please remove your trash and recycling carts off the streets and sidewalks after your cans have been emptied or carts have been emptied. We've had a number of complaints, particularly down the beach, where carts stay out for extended periods of time, and when snow plows come down the street, they're forced to weave around them, which means the street size is reduced because we can't plow the entire width of the street. Please remember that there is no parking on any street in Hampton between the hours of 1 a.m. and 7 a.m. now through April 15th, that's this coming year. Any vehicles in the Ashworth parking lot should be removed as the parking lot is currently closed unless you have, in fact, taken up a winter rental, in which case we will have the lot open for your use. That's it, Mr. Chairman.
Any questions?
Did you find out about those people that were on 9th Street that had the carts full-time right up to the road in front of the foam pole?
We've looked at that, and we've handed over to Public Works for correction because they shouldn't be there. It's an obstacle that causes problems. We have a couple of others that have been brought to our attention as well.
So are they moving them?
Well, we think they're going to move them, yes. We don't want to issue a citation or anything. That's not the objective. We just want to work with the people so that, in fact, it can be done and be done effectively. So,
well, I would hope so because, I mean, it's clearly against the law.
Yes, very clearly. No question. And we have another number of other beach street locations where we're having similar problems. So we're looking at those and looking at them this week because, of course, today's snow melted, but the next event may not happen that way. So we would like not to have a problem down there.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Any other questions for the town manager? Seeing none. Under old business, we have 2017 warrant articles.
I'm cheating. I'm going by my my pre.
So why don't we go by your pre-list?
Mr. Chairman, we had done two extensive lists during your last meeting. We have a number of items that are left over, and we have a new item that's come to our attention. So I try to quickly get through those. And then I believe we have, yes, after this we have the collective bargaining article. So the assistant town manager is here to take care of those. Refuse collection equipment, which was a draft warrant article, has been withdrawn.
Which was number, do you know?
I don't know which number it was, to tell you the truth.
All right.
But it was for more than $1 million, and it's been withdrawn. They're going to go back and restudy that and come back with some information, hopefully next year.
So which one is that?
31.
31.
That was the refuse trucks, transport, semi-trailers, and other equipment?
Yes, that's correct. Yep.
That's been withdrawn.
Right. So that's no longer there. Yes, Article 31. We had another article which dealt with public works equipment, which is article number
DPW
purchases, article 22. And I'm going to ask the public works director, because he was asked to review that and come in with a recommendation to the board as to whether it remains or he wishes to have changes.
Come on up, Mark doesn't bite. Good evening. Article 22. I redrafted it last week. It had some holdover language from last year, which we got done. It's now been written to include just one three-quarter ton truck. That's the weight of the vehicle with plow. Before it said plow and wing. This is a smaller truck. Two 35-pound gross vehicle weight dump trucks. I also included the sand spreader. That is something we normally, when we buy this truck, we did include. It was in the package, but I spelled it out more clearly here. And one solid waste yard truck. That's probably been the major addition to this particular warrant article. The reason for that is the yard horse that we have, we got it for, I don't know, $4,000 about 2 years ago. It's cost us that in repairs. When we try and hitch on to some of our full solid waste trailers and then move them, it's actually uncoupled. And in two instances, we folded the legs up on a fully loaded trailer. And it's cost us $2,000 to get the trailer fixed. My biggest concern with that type of incident is that someone could get injured and it would be a one-time permanent injury. Very much cognizant of that, because in both instances there were staff either attempting to uncouple or couple the trailer to the tractor at the time when it shifted, and only by the grace of God were they not injured. So those are the four. The amount it was increased by was the $60,000 even. We went online, did some research, conversations with Seabrook Truck in the past. They regularly get these in, refurbish them, so hopefully it would be a used one, but a low mileage one, and $60,000 would cover it. And so we looked at what we'd to come up with a 434 figure. It's based upon $30,000 for the three-quarter ton and what we paid for the two trucks that we got this year under the bid process, and that, as I say, $60,000 for the yard horse, what we call the solid waste yard truck.
And I think it's important on the yard horse to understand the other reason and of much importance is to have the hydraulic hoses. Right now, we do not have the capability of being able to move those trailers in and out when they need to be emptied or something is, you know, goes on and, you know, the gears have to be switched. And we've had some issues with them in the past, and we have to wait for the guy that does all the hauling to do them, and he has to stop what he's doing to do it. We also had the fire up at the transfer station, and, you know, we weren't able to pull the ram, for lack of better words, out.
The fire was actually in the trailer. With the yard horse that we have, it doesn't have the hydraulic capacity to operate the ram. So when the fire department got there, we had no way to expose the trash for them to put it out. They literally cut a hole. They were pleased to do it. They cut a hole right in the side of our trailer, and then they filled the trailer with foam. I was concerned that because the foam is slippery and they were on the top of the trailer, that it put them at risk too. The new ones in the future, when we do order them, will have a fire connection to the trailers themselves. But that is one of the reasons why we're looking for a yard horse with full hydraulic capability.
Questions from the board? Regina?
So these four, there are four vehicles here that you're purchasing?
Right. The first three were the ones that were in the CIP.
Okay.
From prior years forward.
Okay. And the fourth one?
Is the yard horse that we've determined
okay.
is the safety issue in the operation of the transfer station.
You have a total figure?
$434,000.
And the 1 ton that we're requesting is actually replacing number 18 that has been sidelined, unfixable from last year.
And it's a three-quarter ton.
The three-quarter ton, excuse me.
It's okay.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Not a wish list?
No. There again, CIP put together a number of years ago. The only thing that was not included in the CIP was the yard horse. It's $60,000. But as I've stated to my staff repeatedly and hopefully to others, if there's safety issues that come up within our operation, I'll cut and scrimp somewhere else to address a safety issue. So if it comes to safety boots, safety jackets, welding gear this year, the lift in the bay, the vehicle lift in the bay that only had a 9,000-pound capacity, all these things, I think it's incumbent upon me as the director to address for the safety of the employees that we have. So, and this is one of those things. The yard horse is a safety issue.
Thank you.
Any questions, Rick? Phil?
Negative, sir.
So we need a motion to
accept or reject, I guess.
Accept or reject.
I'll make a motion that we accept the award article.
Motion to accept the Article 22 as written for the amount of $434 for the said vehicles. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you. The next item, Mr. Chairman, is the fire pumper. And I guess I'll ask the... Do you have another one to...
They have a couple more.
Okay, let's finish. You're right here.
Yeah.
So you've got Article 12, which is the amended Lafayette Road sewer, I believe, Fred.
Yep.
Go ahead.
Okay, so Article 12, it was more of a review of the wording. There was a leftover sentence when it got approved the first time to talk about a companion article. There is not a companion article at this time to it. So the last sentence was removed. So it should end with, it'll be necessary to excavate the eastern side of the highway that will require partial reconstruction of the roadway and patching and repairs.
Period.
So that was the change on 12. We just wanted to let you know that the wording.
So I need a motion to accept the amended Article 12.
I'll make the motion to accept the amended Article 12.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
The other one is the Article 11. It's the Church Street pump station pipe rupture. This article, the amount, I believe, now is now $4.2 million.
Yes.
$4,242,000. And
$4,200,000.
Yeah, just
right. 4-2?
4-2-4-2, which number?
What do you guys?
11.
11.
11, sorry.
Yeah, the number that I had discussed a week ago was just straight $4.2 million. $4,200,000.
And also to emphasize that the impetus for doing this is the
the pipe rupture that was encountered in March.
And as a department, we have no issues with the rewrite or the additional wording, clarification wording that's been proposed by council.
I think we ought to all understand that you're going to try to get this out to public bid.
Yes, the tract is that later this month, into the first week of January, that the plans will be wrapped up. This would be submitted to Concord, and in a parallel track, they would also be bid with the advertisement that awaiting final approval from DES, Corps, Wetlands Bureau, etc.
Is that the same for Lafayette Road?
No. Lafayette Road, we have not started the design process yet.
So you may have, if the bids are successful and they come in, you may have a different figure to look at. So this may be revised again, subject to your approval. And hopefully it's lower.
That would be the goal.
That would be nice.
So we need a motion to accept the new wording?
I'll make a motion to accept the new wording and the
price
of $4.2
million.
$4.2 million.
Isn't it?
He's just saying 4.2.
You're just saying 4.2.
I believe what I presented to the budget committee in last week's hearing was just straight $4,200,000.
Okay.
Do you have anything in the contract? Because it was in that Right Kears memo that.
The drill down is 4242000.
I've been corrected by the. I better have.
Why don't I make it that number? Is it, we already have that written in the language.
Okay.
1,242,000.
Oh, thank you.
And that is the engineer's revised estimate based on all our latest findings.
Thank you. So we have a motion and a second.
And I would just like to say that we still are under no obligation from DES about doing this. I think we're overreacting here. We're also looking at some other options to try to recover some of the money. But to me, this is something that does not have to be done right now. And I'm totally against it.
I just need to say that, you know, some people don't think we're just going over this very quickly. This has been discussed here in length. It's been discussed in the budget committee in length. So everybody has gone over this and over this and over this and over this.
In response to some of the budget committee just comments, you know, one of the things they suggested was having an aerial. We did get an aerial overlay made. We have 8.5 by 11 printouts that we'll have available if anybody needs them to show where we're talking about. Removing it from the marsh and coming down the roadway, those type of things.
Okay, so we have a motion and second. All those in favor? 4, 1 opposed. Very good.
Were we going to revisit Bicentennial because of the way it currently read? If not ready tonight, that's fine.
You're going to have to come back because you need more figures for us, so...
You mean you don't want me to just spring them on you now?
No.
Sounds good. I will get that over to you, and we can revisit that one.
So, Chris, while you were just talking earlier about you replaced one of the lifts over there. Lifts at the in your mechanics bay. So that'll pick up most of the pickup trucks and the one tons now and stuff like that.
Yeah, we went from a 9,000 capacity to a 16,000 capacity. We were picking up $10,000 and $12,000 trucks with the lower capacity lift, and it was there's a huge margin of safety, but it was still a strain, and it just was something we could not live with.
And how about our bigger pieces of equipment? Do we have the lift capability for that?
Well, yes we do. In that, to be honest with you, we never lift them totally off the floor. If, for instance, it's a front axle or front brakes, there's hydraulic portable lifts that we put two of those under there, lift the front end up, do that. Then when we go to rear wheels, rear brakes, tires, same thing, we can lift up the rear end. We have multiple of those. We don't really need a bigger lift. We're never lifting up the whole trash truck, per se, or a dump truck at any one time. It's either one end or the other.
Okay, thank you. Glad you got that new one this year.
Was money that, when we realized the deficiency, it was actually a carryover. It was encumbered money from 15 spent in 16.
Okay, very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next one we have is Article
27, I believe. 27.
Yeah, isn't that the fire truck?
Fire engine?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Chief.
Hello.
Good evening.
Chief and Deputy Chief.
Deputy Chief.
Passing around there, Rusty.
This is fun.
The motion you discussed earlier.
Yeah. Right.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening. How are you?
Very good. How about yourself?
Very well, thank you. We're here to discuss the warrant article for a reserve pump engine pumper. The intention is to give us a stopgap measure to allow us to continue to have a reserve engine at the beach. Currently, we have four fire engines that are deployed. As you may recall, in November, I was here and I discussed the fact that we were finding an issue with the frame on engine two, which is a 2001 Smeal pumper. 2002 is when we took ownership. It was manufactured in 2001. Through some work, some mechanical work that was being performed, there was a cause to put the truck up on a lift in late August. As Mr. Jacobs had just said, it's rare that a truck is actually lifted up, especially a 21-ton vehicle. This truck was lifted up, and in doing so, they examined the undercarriage to a degree that hadn't been done before. It's not, like I said, typical to lift this truck up off the ground. In doing so, one of the larger pieces, I actually have it here as a means to demonstrate, a piece of the vehicle, what we later found out to be the part of the frame, fell off, and it hit the mechanic, which caused him to investigate further. Actually, I'm going to ask you to get that up on it. The large part of the frame that fell off caused him to stop looking underneath and on the inside. There you go. Thank you. This is what fell off. So
that's this part of the frame.
Correct. This is metal that comes from the underside, the undercarriage of the frame. This was identified as a obviously an issue, so he explored a little bit further. And in an area that you can't see, generally speaking, the way we look at our trucks, when we examine them for a daily or a weekly checklist, which we have provided, and I'll give you copies if you need. I gave a report earlier. You'll see a weekly checklist in there as well. The firefighters will go through and they'll look at general wear of the tires. They're going to look at the oil. They're going to look at the coolant, transmission fluids, make sure that the safety part of the vehicle is all working well, wipers and lights and things like that. When it comes to state inspection, it's a similar process. They're looking for all the safety devices on it to make sure that they're all performing as necessary. They check the fluids as well. And when we're sending the truck out for service, typically what we're doing, especially the Smeal trucks, they're not part of, as you know, we've bought Pierce trucks and Smeal trucks, HME Smeal. The Pierce trucks go to Minuteman down in Walpole, Mass., and the Smeal trucks tend to go north. We send them up to National Record to have our mechanical work done. When we're sending them out for work, they're going in specifically for the work that we're calling for. Once a year, we do a state inspection. Just like everybody's vehicles here, we have to have our state inspection. Their checklist is limited, and they find out if all the safety devices are working as appropriate. It's not often that we do put it up on a lift. So when this did go up on the lift and gave them the opportunity to look underneath it, they found that there were several areas that caused them great concern. They contacted the deputy, and he went up to view the vehicle while it remained on the lift, and he called me, and he says, you need to come and see this. So they had to fashion a device to determine the thickness of the steel that remained on some of the portions of the frame. What they did was they actually used threaded rods and they created a caliper to see what the thickness should have been, which is a 3/8-inch thick steel frame that was manufactured during the manufacturing process. It had been reduced down to 3/16 of an inch in some places. It's not visible. It's not in a visible location. When you lift the cab, which is typically how we're going to check all of the fluids on the truck, we lift the cab forward. You can't see where this problem lies. Some of it is underneath the body, and it's not visible as well because of the location underneath where our pump sits on top of the tank sits on top of the frame itself. So we began investigating what it would cost to repair it. The costs were exorbitant to repair it. And when I was sitting in front of you last year and we were discussing purchasing a new fire engine, we had talked about, you know, extending the life of a fire engine. But generally speaking, frontline, we look for 10 years, reserve 10 years. This truck has sat on the front line for 14 years right now. And we were hoping to get a full 10 more years out of it now with the new engine 4 and make that go all the way through. The concern came with the cost and the return on investment. If we're looking at 6 years to complete a 20-year service line for this engine, then in 6 years, the costs that were summed up to us were between $200,000 and $225,000 to replace the frame. So we investigated several other options. Mr. Welch has given some great guidance on that, too. We discussed the fact that replacing the frame wasn't a good return on investment, so he asked, he said, do you think you need a new engine? And I said, well, I think we do. I can't, you know, I don't think that replacing the frame is a good option. So he instructed me to get several options with that. So we looked at the outright purchase price for a fire engine, which came back at about, we use the same spec for engine 4 now, just as a design idea. And that was $679,000, which is a large chunk of change. And in this time, we certainly understand that Hampton is, they're up against it. We can see with all the Warren articles that are presented, this is a very difficult time. So Mr. Welch had also said, well, you know, there's this other option out there. Why don't you look at a lease purchase? So we did that, and I went down with the finance company through the same engine purchasing. And with that, the total payments would be the same. The truck costs would be the same, but it was going to be divided out over 5 years. And then in conversations with Mr. Bridle, he actually said, you know, there's another alternative that we haven't explored yet. And I said, I'm very willing to hear. And he said, purchasing a used fire engine with the option of making that as a stopgap to continue our six-year plan for a reserve piece and bringing in an engine that would get us through that time period. It wouldn't be frontline, and it wouldn't be the intention to be frontline. So the options are out there, and we were starting to look at that. Some of the costs that we were looking at would not only be the purchase price, but also the inspection fees and what it would take to go and look at this piece. One thing that I asked Mr. Welch and Mr. Sullivan and Mr. Bridle to consider is the fact that I don't want to see the fire department take on somebody else's maintenance nightmare. If you're selling a fire truck, generally speaking, you're not doing it because it's in great working order. So I don't want to go buy something that's going to be causing us further problems down the line. So it will require us to make sure that we do due diligence and get the right piece. We are exploring that as an option, and we feel that if that's going to be the decision of the board, $150,000, which was placed forward in the Warren article, would allow us the opportunity to explore that. This is a tough area. New England's a tough area. Between the calcium that we're putting on the roads, the liquid salts that we're putting on the roads right now for treatment in the winter times, and the fact that we work in such a briny environment and tidal pools that are on the roads during the high tides, that causes a lot of erosion, especially on the materials that are underneath in the undercarriage of the truck. So one of the things that we're exploring is looking at getting a truck that is not from this area, that hasn't been exposed to the same elements, and see if that will be a little bit better off for us. There are a lot of reasons for the frame to be going right now, and we've actually discussed those with several mechanics. Part of it is that they're using reclaimed steel. They're not using virgin steel anymore. There's a lot of EPA regulations that are on the paints and finishes, which don't allow the paint to adhere to the metal as well. So we've already taken a measure in advance on engine 4. I did, as the fire chief who bought a fire engine, I didn't want to see a truck go down because of rot. And so engine 4, as it was purchased, the new one, when it arrived in April, we had those frame rails galvanized. And moving forward in the future, that's what I hope to do. Looking forward from here, I think that we need to have a reserve piece. Engine 4, if it goes down for maintenance, if it goes for pump testing, for whatever reason, if it's out of service, we need to have an engine capable of responding to that district if there is a fire call for it, and that's the reason behind the reserve piece. It's also gone out several fires. As you know, in October we saw the Purple Urchin fire. Three of our engines were at that fire, and it was necessary to have them at the time. One of them was down for maintenance. So engine 3 and engine 2 were part of the first new arrival pieces. Engine 4, the brand new one, was having warranty work done at Minuteman. So it wasn't present during that fire, and that could happen any day. So it's up to us to make sure that we're doing due diligence and finding the right piece, but I also would like to tell you that we absolutely need to have that reserve piece because it's there, it's being used quite a bit. So happy to answer any questions.
So what is the status of engine 2 right now?
Currently engine 2, I've taken it out of service. And in the report that I had delivered to Mr. Welch this week, it takes a long time, and not so much... people aren't very forthcoming when it comes to making decisions on taking an emergency piece out of rotation. I really wanted to have a mechanic standpoint on this. I'm not a mechanic. I'm not a strength and materials engineer. So we had it evaluated at three separate locations. Through that process, some of the guys, as I told you, we noticed that there was a 50% loss of material in some areas. We were having a problem for the last 6 months or so where going up the highway, it was noticeable that there was a driving problem, whether it was a shimmy or a shake, it's up to you to determine. But in investigating, we've actually had the steering look at for that, right? We've replaced tires on it. So it's not something that you would think about. But when the mechanical work was performed, the problem wasn't necessarily getting better. And then right away, this came on to our lap. And one of the mechanics who had looked at the piece said, you know, I feel that. We've done the due diligence on what we think could have been the problem. What I think is the problem is that the foundation that the truck sits on, the frame, isn't giving the support necessary. And so that's probably where the problem lies. I feel that this would be a safety issue. And, you know, if something happens, potholes, and we live in New England, potholes, you name it. If something happened and it caused a catastrophic failure of that frame, first of all, the firefighters would be at great risk, and I don't want to do that. Anybody closely related, whether somebody standing on the sidewalk or a vehicle that's driving alongside, would be in great risk. So the decision was made once we realized that it's probably a result of the frame. I took it out of service, and I put it out of service at the beach station at this time.
And so right now you're running with three?
That's correct.
Two frontline engines and one reserve piece.
Did the engine two pass the inspection?
In March it did. We were told in August when this all came through, based on what they now know, they will not pass it going forward without frame rail replacement, because their job is to identify safety issues, and if they do notice one that's potential for catastrophic failure, they can't pass the truck. They pointed this out. They said now we know and you know, this truck's not going to get certified going forward. So theoretically, you know, it's got a sticker on it. Oh, great. But if something happens, and now I've had a mechanic actually tell us, and I provided a report to the board, I don't feel safe with this truck on the road. Based on the thinning of the materials that we're seeing, it's potentially the cause for the steering difficulties that you've been having. It's not steering. It turns left and right. Don't get me wrong. But it shifts lanes. It's a very difficult truck to control. And that's something that we just don't feel safe with.
And if we ordered a brand new truck in March,
sure,
18 months.
We're talking 18 months.
That's true. Yeah, when we first looked at engine four, they were 12 months out. They have had a significant increase in new vehicles, and we were told 18 months from the time of signing.
And that was why I suggested maybe possibly finding something as a stopgap measure.
Agreed.
That we could do, and then we could work on this, have something that would last a couple more years. I mean, fortunately, I know a little bit about this field. I was in it for a little while, so.
And looking forward, what we're trying to do is the criteria we're using, we need a set point. We need to know how much we're willing to spend. As a community, I think that in the discussions were, you know, $150,000 would be, like, that would be the limit. With that as a limit, as you might imagine, a brand new fire engine at $679,000, an old fire engine, they're going to set the price. Now, we know that engine 4, our old engine 4, went and it didn't go for big bucks, but it went, it got sold. It's not being used as a fire engine right now, as far as I know. It might be used as a parade piece. It could be used for anything. We're looking for something that's still going to be a fire engine, so it needs to function. Some of the other criteria that we need, and obviously price point is one of them, we need to have a 750-gallon tank. We need to carry water to the fire. It's important for us to do that. We need a 1,500-gallon-a-minute pump. Not everybody does that. I think that some pumps are considerably lower, but if we're going to be putting out a fire at the beach with a large building or several floors involved, and we've seen that happen down there, we need to have the pump capability to do that. We need large diameter discharges. Not every pump has that. So we're looking to make sure that we get the proper piece, especially if it is temporary, we're looking to get the proper piece in here so that we're able to still continue to do the job.
I know if you've heard, Newington has purchased a used piece recently.
They did.
For a stopgap measure, and they've done it. And so I know it's been, we've done that here a number of years ago when we did ladder trucks at the beach to get something a little newer or something a little better, something a little taller, stronger. So it's not new thinking to do some of these stopgap measures to take hold us over. So, any questions from the board? Bill?
Yeah. I'm not going to support this, and Rusty, it's a great idea, and I'm just saying that our maintenance, you've just been a chief for a couple of years now,
yes,
year and a half, and you've taken that over. The maintenance cycle obviously needs a real look under the hood, no pun intended. Mutual aid, we haven't heard any of the capabilities of Seabrook, Exeter, Northampton, and then following on what they have for responders that can support us. I think that's integral to the issue. Our CERT team for the police department deploys throughout Rockingham County, up into Stratford County. Their leaders, mutual aid, is well established in that platform. So we don't have that, and I haven't heard any of that addressed tonight, and I don't expect an answer tonight, but our mutual aid is a time-established, time-honored tradition, and I think those capabilities probably exist in bordering towns. Seabrook, they can get here quickly. Sometimes they've been the first responders to incidents. And again, the mutual aid, a component of what this is. Buying a used fire truck, to me, is a good idea, and I appreciate that. But at this time, I think we need to re-examine our maintenance procedures, rely on mutual aid. There are myriad demands on taxpayer dollar this year. And for a maintenance cycle that's gone south on that that apparatus, I think requires a sterner look and a pushback until the following year. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Rick?
I'm not going to be supporting it either.
Okay.
Thank you.
I just, one thing I do got to say in defense on maintenance, you know, this town for many years has asked us to put a wash bay in down to the public works. A place that will wash these vehicles, get stuff cleaned out down there, especially these vehicles. They run in such a harsh environment. You know, we don't call them out usually on the best of times. We call them out on the worst of times. When we talk about the ocean overtopping Route 1A, that happens many times, and that's when people call us. You know, and I've been in a fire. You know, the reason why you have those backup stages, those engines, is for the simple reason. Mutual aid works well. We work good with all our area towns. But you can go down, that truck can, you can do your truck check at 6 o'clock at night. 7 o'clock you can go down, have a run, and that truck won't stop. And it has nothing to do with maintenance. It's just the luck of the draw. And so if you don't have something else to hop in, then you've got your 3 or 4 firefighters at the beach sitting there with no way to get there. And that's the problem I see. And that's the problem why you need to have a backup at each station. One time we had 2 backups at the beach. We used to run 5 pumps in this town. We had 3 engines at the beach and 2 uptown. We've gone to that four, 2 and 2, and it's... And sometimes it's shown a challenge. And yes, mutual aid is good. Yes, they do a lot of stuff, but I don't think that, I mean, I don't want to be in that point where that beach engine breaks down and say the uptown engine is out, and so now you got everybody on one engine or everybody on the engine and ladder because that's all there is to ride on. So, Regina?
Could you summarize, engine 2 is a new one. And then the other 2 engines, what are the status?
Engine 4 is the new one.
Engine 4 is the new one.
Yep, 2016. Engine 1 is a 2010 Pierce. Engine 3 is a 2002, I believe, manufactured 2003 acceptance for us. And engine 2 is a 2001 manufactured 2002 acceptance. So the way they design it and build it, they manufactured it in 2001, but the stamp date comes as 2002. It depends on the parts. So it is actually our oldest piece right now, and to that end, it has spent 14 years as a frontline piece. And I do appreciate Mr. Bean's point about mutual aid. One thing that I would like to point out, though, is that we do a lot of maintenance. We really do a lot of maintenance. Frequently, we do once a year pump testing, which is a significant portion of time. It takes about a week to do a full pump test, and the pump is removed from service. It's actually going to Bassetville, Maine. Additionally, any work that's done, it's not done in town. As Mr. Jacobs had mentioned, we don't have a lift capable of doing that. The lift system that they actually use, he said, was a portable hydraulic lift down at DBW. The fire department certainly doesn't have anything that would be allowing us to lift that vehicle. That vehicle's 21 tons. So 42,000 pounds. We just don't have that capability to do that. Mutual aid is a fantastic option, and I don't disagree, but our reserve pumper often becomes our frontline pumper, especially while we're doing pump testing or if we're doing other maintenance and that first vehicle is going down, then that backup pumper becomes the frontline pumper. So that's, I just wanted to make that case.
Do you think that we could get an engine used that fits our needs as the town?
The deputy's been working pretty diligently on finding some of these engines. And like I said, we're not looking local. Some of these are pretty far away.
Yeah, no, that's a good idea. Definitely like Florida or something with
it. Yeah, right. Southern communities where they don't have the exposure to the sand and the salt. And there are engines that are available. And, you know, again, this is one area that I would just caution. And I've expressed my concern about hiring in somebody else's maintenance issues. But finding an appropriate engine, I think it would be feasible, especially for the cost that we've set forward.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
From a risk point of view,
yes, sir.
If you don't have a backup and you have to wait for mutual aid.
Well, as a first response, then their response is from their community. For what it's worth, when it comes to mutual aid, though, we're the first response. And mutual aid typically comes on a second alarm. If we call a second alarm, we're already at the scene, we're already fighting the fire. The second alarm, we know, is taking 7 to 8 minutes, sometimes 10, depending on the community they're coming from. We do have some wonderful sister communities that respond on a dime, but it still is travel time. That's a matter of distance. We have had it where, and Mr. Bridle certainly not incorrect there when he says you get on and that first engine's not starting. It's nice to have something else to go in. And it's really nice if it's bringing water, because that's what puts out the fires. So,
I'm going to support this most likely, as long as you know the deputy doesn't come back and say the engine's in San Diego or something. He has to go out there and check on
it. He's going out himself to pick it up.
Yeah. As long as that doesn't happen.
Now, one of the other things I just, and Mr. Bean can appreciate this is, and I just thought of this, our ISO rating. How does that, right now we're rated with four engines.
33Y. That's right. Yeah. And the 33Y is actually, if I'm not mistaken, ISO changed the way they do their ratings. I believe it was 2012, maybe it was 2013. And in their changes, we actually saw our community get raised to a good stature. 33Y is a very high stature when it comes to a scale of 1 to 9. And it's a very admirable place to be on that list. When the three component talks about water supply, engines able to deliver that water, obviously the hydrants in the district. The 3Y portion, the /3Y portion, that discusses the further out sections, the rural part of the communities that don't have a water supply. This is a very admirable stature. It keeps the insurance rates relatively low. So it definitely does come into part with the availability of all of our engines.
And
I don't know what impact it would have to remove one from service. I haven't done that research.
I didn't even thought of that until we just did. And for the town manager, the way this is written is it'll be coming with the undesignated fund balance.
If you're going to take $150,000, my suggestion is you take up the undesignated fund balance if town meeting approves that. I'm not trying to increase appropriations because I think we already have enough of those to decide on. So if that's the decision the board makes, I would recommend taking surplus.
So that there'll be no impact on
it. No impact, the tax rate.
Okay. So.
Yeah, I have this to say about the ISO rating is we've established that rating, and we're doing so with a vehicle that was essentially being driven when it should have been deadlined, and the maintenance was discovered by a third party. And I have severe reservations about the confidence level in the maintenance of that fleet and vehicles that are that critical to mission accomplishment and are that critical to public safety. And hence, I'm not supporting this, and I'm not supporting a used vehicle from that. And I will say that if we have a rating, that's great, but the rating was based on a false premise. Thank you.
Well, and I can agree with you, Mr. Bean. You know, we used to have a fire department mechanic a number of years ago, and all he did was work on fire department vehicles, and that allowed us to have that. This town and its wisdom decided a number of years ago to do away with that position and have Public Works do it. Then Public Works got overwhelmed. They couldn't do it. So that's why we're in the situation we are now. For a while we had a part-time mechanic that would come in nights, weekends, whenever he could, and do some preventative maintenance. But even that, back 7, 8, 9 years ago, went by the wayside. So, in defense of these two gentlemen there, I mean, they're doing the best they can. Neither one of them are mechanics, so they have to rely on the people that tell them. You know, and shame on us as a town that if we used to have this, position that we've done away with it. And so now our apparatus, and we've here tell, you know, this apparatus that the fire department has is some of our most expensive apparatus in the town. I mean, one of those trucks is probably all of Cruz's. If we look back, you know, Public Works, I dare say they have anything that's worth, not that they don't need it, but it's just not there. These trucks are very expensive. They're very highly technical. We used to have that, and we don't. So to blame the personnel that are there now for, not doing their due diligence, I think they've done what they've been done in the past and done what they do, and they're relying on outside companies. So,
yeah, and I did not use the word blame.
No,
I'm not blaming anybody.
Yeah, I understand that.
And my support for a part-time mechanic would be much more vigorous than my support for a used truck from San Diego. So just wanted to raise that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
What's the old saying? Penny wise and pound foolish.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yes, a lot of issues.
Too close to the ocean.
A lot of issues.
So with that, Mr. Waddell, this is the first truck that we've had with a frame failure, right?
Uh-huh.
So in that time frame, you know, there's something to be said. Look, at the end of the day, this truck was manufactured before I even became a fireman. You know, that 2001, I wasn't a firefighter yet. Here I sit before you now, 15 years later, this vehicle has now got a frame issue. I get it, you know, and I understand Mr. Bean's point. I understand all of it.
You know, it's changes in the time. It's this, it's design. It's everything else.
It's not only the fire service that's feeling it. That's right. The company that we have maintenance performed by, they have several of trucks on a tow fleet that their frames are going. You know, anything in the 2000 range, 2005, and it's interesting. I did contact HME Smeal, our dealer, and they said that, well, about 15 years. You're getting about 15 years on the truck. I said, why is that? They said, because it's bad steel. It was, you know, it is what it is. It's reclaimed. They also, which is strange to me, this is a company that sells fire engines. They put it in writing. They don't want to do the work. They don't want to replace the frame on it. So, you know, I think they see the writing on the wall when it comes to that, too.
And talking to some people that have big trucks, the way to go now is to galvanize the frame, and that's what you did on the last one.
Yes, sir.
I know some of the, you know, the bigger operators, that they're doing that to their trucks now because the steel is so bad. So
I just had a question. You yes, said sir. That they don't want to do the work on the trucks. Well, if the longevity, the average life of the vehicle is whatever, 15 years, you said they never lift it up. They don't usually lift those types of trucks up, right?
Not often, not on inspections, even on tire changes, they're doing it with a hand jack. Right, and yep. That's what I mean.
That's the only way, though, that you can really see the problem.
You need a lift.
Lift it up,
right? So, yeah, you have to be able to. I was able to walk under this vehicle, and I think that this is the first time that engine 2 had been on a lift in years. So it's just not a common practice. It's also a general cost to do that. When we're sending a truck out to be inspected, they're doing what they're doing. Generally, you know, it costs whatever it costs, $35, $90, right, whatever it might be. But their mechanics are. They're working for free at that point to do the inspection, to as far as the business goes, because they have their checklist to go through, and that's what they do.
Yeah, well, maybe it should become sort of a practice that every 4 or 5 years they lift it up and
sure,
look under there and make sure, because like you said, with all the salt and everything in the air around here, it's
bound to happen. Yeah, right. Absolutely. So
So is reclaimed steel Chinese steel or something similar?
Well, it's recycled into some fashion. Some of it may be Chinese steel. Some of it may just be melted down old cars. But it's not virgin steel. It's not produced out of ore in that fashion. So this steel is not coming to us from a factory. It's coming to us through whatever means it might be. And it may not have been, you know, prime steel to begin with. It's been exposed to whatever it's been exposed to as well. It gets melted down. All the imperfections are left behind.
So in the future, when you would be ordering a new truck, would you be making sure that you wouldn't have reclaimed steel?
To be honest with you, I don't know that we could do that. But we're taking the measures to stem that off by having the galvanizing frames. When we were looking at having Engine 4 built in the specs, they were talking about their famous paint procedures, and we really have a great procedure. I said, that's fantastic. And I let them go, but then I said, all right, we're not going to do that. We're going to galvanize these frame rails because we work in a briny environment, and if you ever saw what Brown Avenue looks like after a high tide, we're not going to do that. In my former life, I was in steel construction, putting up beams and things like that and railings, and we galvanized everything. You know, it was just sound practice to do it. So, cheap.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we do the 100 and go with the...
How about if I read the warrant article?
Yeah, read it now.
So... Article 27 as presented, purchase a used fire engine pumper. Shall the town of Hampton vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen with the aid and assistance of the fire chief to purchase a used fire engine pumper to temporarily replace fire engine 2 that has been deadlined due to frame failure, and to raise and appropriate the sum of $150,000 to fund said purchase, with the said sum to come from the unassigned fund balance, the funding containing unexpended appropriations from prior years as of December 31st, 2016, with no amount to be further raised by taxation. Said used pumper will be utilized for at least 4 years until the normal replacement of Engine 2 in accordance with the long-range capital expenditure program. This shall be a non-lapsing appropriation per RSA 32:7-6 and will not lapse until the purpose is completed or March 31st, 2018, which is ever sooner. Majority vote required.
I make that motion.
Motion?
I'll second it.
Second. All those in favor? 3-4. Opposed? 2 opposed.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Okay. Do we have anything else?
Next one, Mr. Chairman, is the Article 38 to amend the fire codes.
Fire codes, okay.
This was pulled from last week. It's been slightly amended since. I leave that to the manager and to the fire chief, deputy fire chief, to explain. We have given the board, I believe, a track changes version to show what changes are being made to the current code.
And rather than I'd rather you guys explain it than me try to read 2 and 3 pages of...
Certainly. Okay. So when I became the fire chief, I had discussed with Mr. Welch his desire to have seen some of the language cleaned up in Chapter 167, which is the town ordinances for fire prevention. I had come to see the board here to discuss the fee schedule, but most of the other language was remaining what had been historical. Some of the language that was in there referenced materials that we no longer use, systems that are no longer employed, master box systems, which were rendered defunct in 2007. My goal was to bring forward current code language so that any business owner or general contractor coming in to do business with the fire department would be able to reference one location, see what's expected of them, not have to read all the way through and say that this section was repealed and then move on to the next. So basically what we did is we cleaned up the language where it was needed to indicate what was currently being used. In some instances, we also added what we're using as part of our application process, so the actual language is in there. There are 2 changes that were definite changes to this. One of them is a request to put in a Cat 30 key for the panels. A Cat 30 key is a type of key that everybody's familiar with if they're in the fire service. It's very common. Some panels, if you see the fire alarm panels in the hallways and whatnot, they have a key in there that may be proprietary. There are different panel manufacturers, But that barrel, that key barrel, is about $5 to change out. And what we're looking to do is have one key for the entire community. So the Cat 30 key reference is in there. And similarly, there's a change to bring about to code standard right now. Any type of trouble signal coming in right now, according to the ordinances, it comes in as alarm, which means that if there's a trouble, whether it's a sprinkler activation, or I'm sorry, a tamper switch, if somebody messed with the sprinkler system, it would ring in as an alarm. What that means is we're going to come with two engines and a ladder with lights and sirens because we're going there as if the building is on fire. When it's really just a trouble signal, it means that we need to go check it out. So we'll send one fire engine with traffic to go check it out. We feel that that's a safer option. That's also within national code, the NFPA code, which is 72. So we brought that standard back to national code.
That's about it.
Any questions?
Make a motion that we accept those changes to the code.
Any second? Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Have a great
night. One more thing.
Thank you.
One more tonight. Yeah.
Thank you.
One. Oh, we got one more.
I do.
No. You're done.
Not me. Oh,
you're done.
Okay. Have a great night.
Good, Chief.
Thanks.
For the last two or three years, the Recreation Department has been submitting petition or warrant articles to do major work at Tuck Field. And for the last two or three years, we've had to postpone that work because other things are much more urgent. So, just an idea. It may not go any further than our discussion this evening. We have, after we pay all of our bills from the reserve account for the Recreation Department, and after we pay the bills for next year's appropriations, if they're made, we still have between $85,000 and $90,000 left in that account, not including next year's contributions of 20% from the parking lots. What I'm going to suggest to you for your thought is that we take and form a capital reserve fund, and we take $50,000 of these extra funds, put them in there specifically for the purpose of doing the work that the Recreation Department would like to do to Tuck Field. Bring it up to standard, bring the buildings up to standard. In fact, I'll read it for you so you understand what I'm talking about. To establish a capital reserve fund under RSA 35:1 for the construction, reconstruction, and modifications to the Parks and Recreation Department Tuck Field facilities for the purposes of, one, added storage space for the department materials, and for their four-season activities, thereby allowing the department to centralize and better control its resources. Two, to provide for added office and activity space to meet the increased needs for the department, many departments, many year-round activities and administrative work area needs. And three, for added space for activities for our senior citizens as their activities have substantially outgrown the available space. The Capital Reserve Fund shall be known as the Tuck Field Improvement Capital Reserve Fund, etc. And the $50,000 would be added to that account from the Recreation Infrastructure Special Revenue Fund. I don't know if the board has interest in doing that or not, to try to start putting some money aside to do something with the facilities down there that are going to need to be modernized in the near future.
Rick?
It sounds interesting. I'd like to hear what everyone else has to say.
Just a thought, that's all.
Phil?
Money's money, and I know it comes through, and I thank Mr. Welch for bringing it forward, and I just think that we're looking at the numbers. We just said no to a fire truck, or at least I did, and Rick did, and we've got other stuff going on, and it's hard to transition to the playground, and I've got grandkids, and I like going to the playground. We go to the center school. We go to the school stuff. That's in good shape. So I think that it's well intentioned, and I know it is, and it comes from a good source. And I would like to see a look at it next year. Thank you,
Regina.
Yeah, I think that right now, this. I mean, I approve the fire truck, but I think right now that we need to start. I think it's not the time to move $50,000 out of the Tuck Field Fund right now for this.
Jim?
I'd like to look it over.
I would also like to look it over. You know, I can't tell you how many years we've talked about a community center or a senior center or whatever here. So if we can, at some point, if it's not this year, and I'm not necessarily that this is the right year, but we have to start looking at that down the future. Mm-hmm. We've talked about our senior citizens having a place to go for years and years and years, and every year it gets shot down. Well, this would be a way to do it. And if we don't do it this year, hopefully it'll be looked at for next year. So I think if...
The senior center part, or, you know, for the seniors, is the part that makes it interesting to me.
Yeah. That's the
biggest. And I think this is something that... I like the idea of establishing the fund, and but I think next year is a better year to try it.
Okay.
That's the advice I'm looking for. Thank you.
Was there the streets? Was there one that we wanted to take out?
There's one that we have to take out, so Surf Avenue, and that's now part of a development, so it's a private road. And we're going to leave it private. We're not going to ask to accept it simply because of an action by the planning board in a development proposal that was presented, and that will come out of the original document.
That's Surf Street?
Surf Street.
And where's that? Down at Surfside?
Off of Bonaire.
Yeah.
It feeds into the back of a condominium on Winnicott Road.
Okay. So what is that a new...
It's something that was built a number of years ago. There are a lot of streets.
It's a paper street, I believe.
Are those little houses?
This is a four-unit condo that sits on Winnicott.
Oh.
And this the street that was created a number of years ago but never built was used as a driveway access for the parking behind the building. Mm-hmm. So, and we discovered that there was a sort of covenant on the property in the paper street. So we don't want to accept it because it's now the responsibility of somebody else. There's no sense spending taxpayers' money. We're not going to clean it. We're not going to do anything with it. So it's going to remain a private road. And we've already put the covenants on file that we've discovered today in our road record accounts. So it will remain private as it is.
And does it work well where those people go and park in on the back there?
They're not parking on the street, so they must be parking behind.
Yeah, because they're not supposed to park on the street. I was on the planning board when that was passed, or probably the zoning board, I'm not even sure. And there wasn't supposed to be parking on the front, and I see people park there all the time.
Well, they do park there occasionally, but I don't see them parking there overnight.
Good. That's,
which I think is the big objective. I mean, people come and go, so it's a little easier to park on one kind of road when you're coming and going. But I don't see overnight parking there.
Good.
So you would simply need a motion to amend that article, now 39, to remove that
one. I'll make that motion.
Good. Second. All those in favor? Yeah, that was a paper street that went into the back of Stanley Lewis's old house.
Is that where it was?
Yep. Yeah, okay. And there's another one down there called Rye Court that used to be down there. It's also a paper court that's not on that list.
Yep.
But it's something that might eventually come up.
We didn't put it on the list.
You live in that area.
That's good stuff. Yeah.
We didn't put it on the list because that already had a notation.
Well, you know, when I was in the fire service, you always had to know your streets.
Oh, yeah.
And when you wanted to get somebody, go, where's the right court? And they couldn't tell you if it was a paper street. So, okay. Anything else on the old business? Is that old business or new business?
New business.
New business.
New business.
So we have new businesses, tentative collective bargaining agreements.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So we're here tonight to report back on the actions of the team that was put forward by the board to negotiate contracts on behalf of the unions that were up. There were four contracts. I'm pleased to report back that based on the goals the board set for the team for Mr. Bean, Attorney Girard, myself, that we've reached tentative agreements with all four of those unions. So I'll present them to you tonight and ask that we'll take this in two parts. The first part, I'll go over the agreements for you and the public, ask that you vote to ratify each one of those. And then we'll talk about the warrant articles afterwards and the wording of the warrant articles after we've answered all your questions, okay? So in general, just doing the overview, again, four units. They included the Teamsters, the Public Works Employees Union, and two units in the fire department, the firefighters and the fire supervisors. In general, they are all three-year deals. They, in general, are all 3-3-3, with one exception, that is the Teamsters. I'll get into that. They include both language that was important to us previously with regard to the Cadillac tax, excise tax, that protects the town from any impact should that remain. As you recall, that was kicked down the road a little bit by the federal law. And all of our contracts now, if these should pass, will have the protective language. So no matter what happens with that, the town is protected and the taxpayers are protected from any impact on that. Everybody has agreed that if that should happen, and those, as you know, those high-cost plans, if those should be implemented and the tax is assessed, they will either move to a plan which doesn't impact it, or they will pay those costs and the taxpayers won't. Second is that based on some changes on our insurer, there needed to be a change in the prescription medical plans. Each of these four units have agreed. The options weren't good, but in the end, everybody's going to agree to move in 2018 to a new prescription medical plan. That plan will save the town money, and it will save the individual's money. In part of doing that, there will be a change in what all of these folks are used to for their their prescription reimbursement plans. So we've created a fund where what was previously covered will be covered during the period of the contract. We'd put some money aside for that sort of incentive to move us in that direction. And again, I think it's very important to say there will be savings for both parties as a result of this. So it's a good thing. Now I'll go through, I think that's overall what we did, kind of the global for each. I'll go through each of them now more specifically and answer any questions you have. I'll start with the Teamsters, Local 633. The Teamsters, as you may not know, is a group of folks across a number of different places. There's folks in the town office, dispatchers and civilian employees down at the police department, as well as some folks down at Public Works. It covers a number of those folks. Primarily, I'll focus on cost items, but the board, you've all received these items, so you understand what these are. We've made some corrections and updates to the recognition clause, no cost item related to that. Some adjustments in the disciplinary procedures section of their contract, again, no cost item to that, but clarified some issues. There is a new agreement for folks in the public works who work during storms and what have you. If they're held in for an excessive period of time, which is not unusual in the public works department for a plowing circumstance or some emergency for a very, very long period of time, and they're not able to get out to get meals, we see this as a very small cost item. We'll either supply them a meal or do a reimbursement, which the director wishes to deal with. Health insurance, got several issues to talk about in these. One is, as you recall, the direction from the board was we're migrating folks, trying to incent them to come to look more at their health plans and give them an opportunity, if they wish to come off the plan, to make it more of an incentive. The numbers were very low in the past. We've agreed, as we did with the police department in the past, to increase those, that if they opt out of the insurance, they choose to go on somebody else's plan and show us that. For a single plan, we'll pay $2,000. For a two-person, $3,000. For a family, $4,000. With respect to the Cadillac tax, we talked about that. There's a section in there. And the new section that deals with the insurance that I also overviewed briefly, we go through in this agreement how that will be put in with regard to migrating to that new plan in 2018. Everyone stays the same in 2017, and you must make the new selection beginning in 2018 and remain there going forward. So those cost savings to the town will remain in each of those years moving forward. The wages, as I said, first year is going to be a 3%. We've added a step. Right now, their contract runs from newly hired to 5 years. We've added a step at 1 year for 3%. So essentially, that first year cost of living adjustment for everybody will be 3%. We've made an adjustment based on agreement for positions that were substantially below peer group, something we've been doing, you know, throughout the non-union. We did the same in here. I believe there's six total positions that we'll make an adjustment for in year one as well. The maximum anybody will see on that, those six positions, that the adjustment will be is no more than 8%. I know that sounds like a big number, but again, some of those are very low-paying jobs that we move to a more reasonable number. And again, where they wanted that 3%, and we made this adjustment, in years 2 and 3, they've agreed to a 2%. So it's really, it's a 3% year 1, 2 and 2. And then there's an adjustment in that first year in the wages. In addition, we've talked about creating a new operations coordinator in the building department and discontinuing the secretary's position. And we added a clause to give management some flexibility in hiring highly skilled folks. We've had some issues, not issues, but we're hiring to recruit the best candidates and given the ability, if needed, that we can place people on that for highly skilled positions, foremen, that type of thing, so that we can recruit very qualified folks to some of these positions. We see some retirements coming in the future. That's the Teamsters contract as an overview. And again, we think it's very fair. We think it's it was a long time getting to. It took us, I think we started sometime in September with all of these groups or before that. And I'm very pleased with the results. Be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions?
No, yes.
Just reiterate.
Yes, sir.
For the town, one of our most important things was protect ourselves from future insurance.
Yeah, absolutely. Our direction from the board was to go in and negotiate. Cadillac tax was something we were all very, very concerned with. And the insurance issue was something foisted upon us in the middle of our negotiations. And that had risk to us. If we weren't able to resolve that issue, we could have been exposed to paying that prescription claims down the road. It could have led to derailing the entire thing. I think we've made very good progress talking with units, and I think we've solved that issue.
So we've moved with them on raises, and they've moved with us on insurance.
That's correct. And we expect to see savings moving forward from that prescription change. Again, we'll realize actually a higher number, but the individuals also see a savings themselves going forward. Yes, sir.
And what about the 8%?
So again, it's important to understand those percentages can be challenging. You know, you got to look at the actual dollar figures. The positions that had those greatest things were, you know, secretarial positions paying, you know, $14 or less, where in other areas we had people making more than that for the same position. So we equated those. You know, looking at the real dollars, I think is how it's best to look at those. But we thought those were fair presentations based on, you know, what frankly were the lower end of the pay scale. We were doing major ones, and again, there were only six of those positions total that had a salary adjustment.
And that's just here at...
with the Teamsters unit, correct.
And that's not going to be in the other...
No, all the other units are consistent with what we were directed to, the 333. And again, in this one, because there were more changes in the first year, they have less... They went essentially three with those adjustments to two, where all our other units are going to be 333 across the 3 years.
Thank you.
Okay.
Phil? Yeah, thank you. Attorney Gerald, how much did outside counsel cost for union negotiations in the past per unit, ballpark?
Well, it was $35,000 was budgeted each year up until the year 2016.
So we've saved that amount this year. You two have done an extraordinary job, and there were challenges that have not been faced by boards in the past. You negotiated last year, which was the Cadillac tax. An extraordinarily difficult negotiation, and very important to the union members who work hard and have tough jobs. Policemen, firemen, and people that are out there 24 hours a day at Public Works in all kinds of weather. So great job with you folks, and I, of course, support your efforts. Mr. Sullivan, your billet in here is the assistant town manager and chief negotiator. He's proved extraordinarily clairvoyant. So we appreciate that. You are a force multiplier for excellence. And there had been some lean years in this town in the past in negotiations. There was a recession in 2008, and union members and people remain loyal. Those that have remained loyal in this town as employees have moved up the ladder. We've seen that all the department heads were hired from within. There was no external search. So there is a light at the end of the tunnel, and this is a great town with great taxpayers and great citizens. And we've got great employees, and I fully support these contracts, and thank you.
Well, I just want to say it was because of these two gentlemen. It was also because of you, Mr. Bean, being part of that negotiating team. You guys did an effective job. You worked at it. I know it always hasn't been easy, but you dealt with it, and it took the three of you to do that. And I, as one board member, appreciate that. I will read the article so that everybody knows what it is. 12-12.
Might suggest we come back to the articles after. Let's go through each contract.
That's fine, however you want to do it.
Assume that you wish to ratify, and then we'll come back to the language.
Okay.
If that works for you.
All right. So
you want the motion?
I move the board, but if you'd like to do that, I think that makes sense.
Move to ratify the tentative agreement as presented between the town and the Teamsters Local 633 and authorize Chairman Bridle to sign the agreement on behalf of the board.
Second.
Any questions? All those in favor? Unanimous.
The next one I'll touch on is the Public Works employees. That is the Hampton Public Works employees, SEIU Local 1984. And again, in the global issues we just discussed with regard to Cadillac tax and insurance, those are also included in this contract. It is a three-year contract, 333, over its current setup. There are a couple of other items in there. One is that we did put in talk to them about folks that go to school and benefit us, this program called the Rhodes Scholar Program. And that is a series of training that are 25, 50, 75, and 100 hours worth of training on each milestone. And it's beneficial to us. It's folks who can help us get our roads in good shape. So what we agreed to is there are milestones in each Rhodes Scholar, 1, 2, Senior Rhodes Scholar, Master Rhodes Scholar. And we've done annual payments for essentially education, equivalent that we see in other unions with education benefits. So for Rhodes Scholar 1, a $300 one-time payment a year. For the Rhodes Scholar 2 achievement, $450. For Rhodes Scholar, Senior Rhodes Scholar, $600. And for Master Rhodes Scholar, again, the 100 hours, is a $1,200 one-time non-cumulative. So we felt that was a reasonable milestone to incent our folks to continue their training. Again, the health insurance issue, same issues we discussed with the Teamsters, the same opt-out provisions we discussed with the Teamsters, same excise tax we discussed with the Teamsters, there was a change with leave administration. Again, this is not a cost factor issue, but it's an operations issue. Previously, they were required to take four-hour increments. If they went to watch a son's ball game or something in that case, we've agreed to allow those to be in one-hour increments with department approval. Some adjustments to the bereavement leave, adding things that were missing previously. And then a cost item, the final cost item in their contract is in the stipends that they get, pardon me, for buying a pair of boots. Pardon me. We've increased that by $150 per man upon proof of meeting approved by the department, meeting the standards in there. And again, it's boots for what these folks do can be fairly expensive, so we felt that was a reasonable number. And that is an overview of the Teamsters, the Public Works Employees, SEIU 1984.
Any questions? Regina? Jim?
No.
Negative.
So? I think all the same remarks from the previous one. Well, most of that is for this one also.
Yes, sir. And that seems consistent throughout, again, with the goals of this board were to try and keep the negotiations as on those major issues as close as possible, and that's what we attempted to do.
I move to ratify the tentative agreement as presented between the town and the Hampton Public Works Employees, SEIU Local 1984, and to authorize Chairman Bridle to sign the agreement on behalf of the board.
Second that.
Any questions? All those in favor? Unanimous.
Now there's two more, and that is the firefighters. We'll start with firefighters local 2664. Pardon me. And on theirs, again, the opt-out provision is the same, 234. The issue with regard to the health insurance and the migrating plans is the same. The Cadillac tax language is the same. And something we'll see with them now is, which we felt was the direction of the board and very important, and to this point in time, the firefighters have not, as the other units have in prior negotiations, have migrated and paid a higher, new employees have paid a higher percentage of their costs. So, it was a phased-in thing where prior negotiations have taken new employees and that they're going to pay a percentage higher than the current employees to see future savings. In the fire service, they chose to take a different approach, which we agreed to under this contract. They have not paid that additional percentage in any of the prior contract negotiations, and they have agreed to do so now. And what we're going to do is migrate them in a payment. They don't want to create a two-tier. They're very in the fire service. It's very important to them that they maintain, and new employees and the current employees remain paying the same. So what's different here is all of the employees as opposed to just the new ones, are going to pay a higher percentage. So we're going to realize more savings to the town, or that money's going to be recovered quicker in the short term, where the other one, it's a long-term solution. This is in the immediate. So what they're going to do over the 3 years is move that 1.5% additional pay. So in the first year, and if it's passed in 2017, they'll pay an additional percentage. In the second year, it'll remain at that 1%. And in the third year, it'll add additional 0.5%. So it'll be 1.5 over the 3 years of additional payment. They, too, will have the pool. The Cadillac tax, as I mentioned, is the same. There is some language to allow them to take advantage of the 457 deferred compensation plan. Federal loan programs that we already have under policy, been included in language here. They are also a 333 over the 3 years. There was also some adjustment in regard to they have a long-standing number of stipends for various milestones in their training with regard to, for example, if you're an EMT advanced, a paramedic and such. We've agreed to that maximum previously had been 17%. We've agreed to move that to 18%, as well as add a percentage now for, as you know, we have a very robust marine safety program that requires some pretty advanced training. So what we've agreed to is if they complete three training, rescue swimmer, state boat operator school, as well as the advanced boat operator school, that they can also now put that into that pool for that additional percentage that falls in with what their other issues are. So again, it's three requirements to receive that. There was also a percentage for the fire alarm operators to have advanced training. And again, similarly, that the public safety telecommunicator and tactical dispatch, again, milestones in training. There's some language, again, not a cost item with regard to making recommendations. It was in the contract previously, but had expired some time ago about an FPA standard 1500, which is a professional standard that sets sort of a best practices. And we've agreed to spend time both with union members and department members to relook at those standards and make recommendations going forward on best practices. Many of these standards cost money. We're very clear that that would have to go through the budget process. None of them are binding, but to put the best practices forward for a consideration in the future if need be. None of those being, again, binding cost items. And that's the extent of 2664s.
Any questions, comments?
Yeah, just real quickly before your motion, Jim, is in the boat incentives, if the boat service is terminated, the position of the town.
Thank you, sir. Yes, and again, we saw that with the neighbors in Portsmouth, where when they discontinued theirs, there was not a controversy, but a discussion about the contract language. We have added language in there that if that should be discontinued, then those incentives would go away as well. Not that we envision that occurring, but if that happens, we put protective language in there.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Sullivan.
I move to ratify the tentative agreement as presented between the town and Hampton Firefighters Local 2664 and to authorize Chairman Bridal to sign the agreement on behalf of the board.
Second by Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous.
And finally, the Firefighters of the Department Supervisors Association, Local 3017. And again, on the global issues, they remain the same with regard to the opt-out provision, the changes in medical, the additional contributions that they will be making. Supervisors are doing that as well. The pool for reimbursement of the medical, again, everything we've discussed there, the Cadillac tax. The two other differences that we've put in here have to do with, again, issues on the education benefit, something we saw similar. There were none of those in the supervisor's contract. So we did put in language for either a $300, a $500, or $1,000 one-time payment annually for either having 30 credit hours, an associate's degree, or a bachelor's degree, and expanded some language that previously told the one person in the unit with regard to longevity pay for milestones of service of 10 years, 15 years, 20, and 25 years. 333 over the 3 years. And those are the cost items that I see. Be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions?
Yeah, so I just want to say, so when the firefighters, they pay in now, they've never done that before.
That's correct.
The additional amount. So it's going to be 1.5% over the next 3 years.
Exactly. Same as 2664. First year, 1%, zero. Second year, another 0.5% in the final year.
And you
and that stays forward.
And Mr. Bean succeeded in doing that this year.
At the board's direction, yes, we did.
Thank you.
And
I move to ratify the tentative agreement as presented between the Hampton Fire Department Supervisors Association Local 3017 and to authorize Chairman Bridle to sign the agreement on behalf of the board.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Now, if you want to loop back to the language in the warrant articles.
Yep.
And the costing items. But we'll invite Christy back up if she'd like to join us. You folks all have copies of the warrant article language?
Yep.
How would you like to proceed, Mr. Chairman?
Well, I think we should read them so that they're clear. That way there we can vote.
Would you like me to do that? Or?
Sure. If you'd like to read those, I'd love it.
So Article 17 would be the first. Shall the town of Hampton vote to approve the cost items included in the three-year collective bargaining agreement reached between the Hampton Board of Selectmen and the Professional Firefighters of Hampton Local 2664, which calls for the following increases in salaries and benefits at the current staffing level. 2017, $92,801 for 39 weeks over the 2016 level. 2018, $130,502 for 52 weeks over 2017 level. 2019, $125,006 for 52 weeks over the 2018 level. And in 2020, $30,587 for 13 weeks over the 2019 level. And further, to raise and appropriate the sum of $92,801 to fund the cost items related to the Professional Firefighters Local 2664 salaries and benefits for 2017. Such sum represents the additional salaries and benefits over the 2016 budget level for the first of 3 years that are contained in a collective bargaining agreement between the Town of Hampton by its Board of Selectmen and the Professional Firefighters Local 2664 pursuant to RSA 273-A. The compounded cumulative cost impact over the three-year contract years of the agreement is estimated to be $782,076. Majority vote required. And then the fiscal impact note by the Finance Department estimates the estimated 2017 tax impact on $92,801 is 0.028 cents per $1,000 of valuation or 2.8 cents per $1,000 of valuation.
Any questions?
I know why you wanted me to read that.
There you go. Any questions?
So moved.
So moved. Second?
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Article 18. Shall the town of Hampton vote to approve the cost items included in a three-year collective bargaining agreement reached between the Hampton Board of Selectmen and the Hampton Fire Department Supervisors Association, Local 3017, which calls for the following increases in salaries and benefits at the current staffing level. 2017, $51,703 is 39 weeks over the 2016 level. 2018 is $76,991, which is 52 weeks over 2017 level. 2019, $71,686, 52 weeks over the 2018 level. 2020, $17,987, 13 weeks over the 2019 level. And further to raise and appropriate the sum of $51,703 to fund the cost items related to the Hampton Fire Department Supervisors Association Local 3017 salaries and benefits for 2017. Such sum represents the additional salaries and benefits over the 2016 budget level for the first of 3 years that are contained in the collective bargaining agreement between the Town of Hampton by its Board of Selectmen and the Hampton Fire Department Supervisors Association Local 3017 pursuant to RSA 273-A. The compounded cumulative cost impact over the three contract years of the agreement estimated to be $448,858. Fiscal impact note, Finance Department estimates 2017 tax impact on $51,703 is 0.016 cents per $1,000 valuation or 1.6 cents per $1,000 of valuation.
Make the motion that we approve.
Motion. Second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Article 19. Shall the town of Hampton vote to approve the cost items included in a three-year collective bargaining agreement reached between the Hampton Board of Selectmen and the International Brotherhood of Teamsters Local 633, which calls for the following increases in salaries and benefits at the current staffing level. 2017, 54,274 is 39 weeks over the 2016 level. 2018 is $52,436, 52 weeks over the 2017 level. 2019 is $35,655, 52 weeks over the 2018 level. 2020 is $7,965 for 13 weeks over the 2019 level. And to further raise and appropriate the sum of $54,274 to fund the cost items related to the International Brotherhood of Teamsters Local 633 salaries and benefits for 2017. Such sum represents the additional salaries and benefits over the 2016 budget level for the first of 3 years that are contained in a collective bargaining agreement between the Town of Hampton by its Board of Selectmen and the International Brotherhood of Teamsters Local 633, covering various positions at the Town Office, Department of Public Works, and Police Department, pursuant to New Hampshire RSA 273-A. The compounded cumulative cost impact over the 3 years of the contract, the agreement is estimated to be $351,428, majority vote required. Fiscal impact note, the Finance Department, the estimated 2016 tax impact on $54,274 is 0.016 cents per $1,000 evaluation, 1.6 cents per $1,000 evaluation.
Motion.
I make motion.
Motion. Second. Any questions? All those in favor? Unanimous.
Article 20. Shall the Town of Hampton vote to approve the cost items included in a 3-year collective bargaining agreement reached between the Hampton Board of Selectmen and the State Employees Association, SEIU Local 1984, which calls for the following increases in salaries and benefits at the current staffing level. 2017, $72,237, which is 39 weeks over the 2016 level. 2018 is $99,321, which is 52 weeks over the 2017 level. 2019, $81,384, 52 weeks over the 2018 level. And 2020, $16,974, which is 13 weeks over the 2019 level. And further, to raise and appropriate the sum of $72,237 to fund the cost items related to the State Employees Association, Inc., SEIU Local 1984 salaries and benefits for 2017. Such sum represents the additional salaries and benefits over the 2016 budget level for the first of the 3 years contained in the collective bargaining agreement between the Town of Hampton by its Board of Selectmen and the State Employees Association, Inc., SEIU 1984, Public Works Employees, pursuant to New Hampshire RSA 273-A. The compounded cumulative cost impact over the 3 contract years of the agreement is estimated to be $576,946, majority vote required. Fiscal impact note, Finance Department. The estimated 2017 tax impact on $72,237 is 0.022 cents per $1,000 valuation, 2.2 cents per $1,000 of valuation.
I'll make a motion that we approve.
Motion. Second. Questions? All those in favor? Unanimous.
Anything else we can do for you folks? Everybody good here?
I think that's
any other questions? Thank you.
Good job. Thank you. That was a mouthful.
Yeah.
Thank you for reading that.
Four mouthfuls.
You need my glasses halfway through. Mr. Chairman, if I could leave these with you for signature. Well, never mind. I'm here. I'll
okay. Anything else under new business?
Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a right-to-know law motion, please.
Okay.
I hereby move to direct the town attorney to send in behalf of the Board of Selectmen an RSA 91-A request for information to all members of the Budget Committee requesting copies of any and all written correspondence, including but not limited to emails directed to a quorum or majority of the Budget Committee members among themselves and from others regarding matters being considered by the Hampton Municipal Budget Committee.
We have a motion.
I'll second it.
Is there a second? Any discussion? All's in
discussion. Yeah, I'd like the town attorney's input on the genesis of this issue.
Yes, thank you. There have come to my attention several emails, some of which are from the chairman of the Budget Committee, directed to all members of the Budget Committee. Now, this is something that has occurred before in other towns and has been the subject of major litigation, very costly to those other towns, in which it is deemed that the sending of such emails creates the opportunity for contemporaneous communication among members and essentially is a public meeting without following the requisites of a meeting. And in one major case at the Superior Court level, which has been brought to the attention of the Budget Committee last year as well as this year, and other town boards here that I've spoken to, the result has been that the actions of the committee have been found to be invalid and have been invalidated by the court. Significant attorney's fees have been assessed against the towns involved, representing several hundred thousand dollars, and not only incurring their own attorney's costs, but having to pay the other side's costs, and also ordering those bodies to undergo training in the right to know law. And so we've warned the Budget Committee about that. The New Hampshire Municipal Association in their lectures has warned the Budget Committee about that. And unfortunately, there seems to be still emails that are in violation of the right to know law. And it's important to not only to have that stop, but to understand what's going on that's communication outside the public meeting. And that is what this motion is directed to.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Jerome. Mr. Chairman, when I was a selectman, served with the appointed chairman of the Budget Committee, I had Mr. Welch terminate my email access from that select board member for this same reason and refused to continue that illegal practice. It was perennial. It was continuous. And it would not stop. There's been education levels by the New Hampshire Municipal Association, by the town attorney. There are two important governing laws amongst the myriad that public officials subject themselves to for the big bucks, as we say, that we make here. And one is a Selectman 41:8, and that is to govern the prudential affairs of this town. It's a $60 million revenue plus bonded articles. That's split down the middle with the school, is operations more or less. It's an important corporation. We saw the breadth and scope of the warrant articles. We see the life safety. We see the protection of property in human life. The other is 91A, and that is that the people in this town, in the Prudential Affairs Clause of the Selectmen, have confidence that the meetings of those that they elect, and in this case, Ms. Woolsey, that is appointed, they are making no decisions privately. They have no consensus, and that's the genesis of Mr. Waddell's motion. And this is very, very important, and it continues. And there are myriad examples that I have personally viewed in the last several weeks and the several months. Additionally, there appear to be third parties that are having their material cut and pasted into the Budget Committee members. And I could be wrong, but it would appear to the layman and the disinterested party that there are third parties that are contributing to Budget Committee communications that are going to a full quorum about decisions. And there's outside legal counsel, if I may say so, the New Hampshire Municipal Association has reviewed this. They have recommendations that are more stern than this simple 91A, but the public needs to know about this. The legal reference that town council alludes to has been part of the briefing and the in-doc, if you will, for all board members. And that was done by this board and the town manager and Mr. Gerald. And it's Porter versus Sandwich. Hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars of legal expenses, reversals of decisions. And the Budget Committee is voting on budgets. They have a significant influence in this town, and rightfully so, because the town has decided to have that. But there appears to be a perennial violation of a fundamental and important law. And if we as selectmen allow this to continue, then what other laws do we not bring to the attention of the people that are being violated? And we have police departments, our police department, a fire department, we have zoning, we have all myriad regulations, ordinances, and laws that we are upheld and we are trusted to enforce. And that comes under the Prudential Affairs, and it's a state statute. It's very, very important. This is a difficult subject to bring up. It's one that we have educated all boards about in the Budget Committee with their appointed chairman, not elected,
who used to sit as a select person, refuses or is incapable of stopping, and that is the reason that we have to have this unpleasant conversation this evening. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Town Esquire.
And you've had correspondence with the committee about this, yes?
Yes.
You've...
I have. When one of these emails came out, I responded that this is an email that seems that violates the right to know law, potentially exposes the committee to having its actions invalidated, and worse.
And you've consulted.
I've run by those same communications by the New Hampshire Municipal Association, which has indicated that yes, these are communications that are in fact a public meeting outside of a public meeting.
And I just wanted to state that Stephen Buckley explained that at the NHMA seminar that was requested by the Budget Committee back in May. And yes, I'm included in the emails as well, and have told them numerous times that I will never respond to any of those emails. And yet they still continue to ask me to email the whole group rather than the chairman, because sometimes the chairman doesn't get the email off to them. I won't do that. I mean, I don't know what the problem is, but they don't understand it. Various members of that committee do not understand it. They think if no one responds, it's okay. That's not how the law works.
Correct.
Are there any other boards that are doing this? Other instances of other boards in Hampton?
Not to my knowledge. When this Porter versus Sandwich decision came out, I met with a number of the other boards, in addition to the Budget Committee, to brief them on what this law means, and that case in particular.
Any other questions? So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, if I might, before closing, I'd ask that the board go into a non-public session under RSA 91A, :3, Roman 2, small e, litigation.
Motion.
Second. A motion.
The motion? Second? Need a roll call?
Yes, please.
Aye. Closing comments. Seeing none, I want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas. Oh, no, we're here next week. Sorry.